Hello and welcome. My name is Deepshikha, and on behalf of Team She the People, I welcome you all to this day-long Digital Women's Writers Festival for September. I take great pride in the fact that I have been closely associated with organizing some of these digital events, and the experience has been truly phenomenal. Over the last 5, 6 years that we have been organizing Women's Writers Fest, this fest has emerged as one of the largest writers' festivals for women. And we have endeavored to showcase works by women in different genres, every field, and cutting. And the pandemic has enabled us to cut across geographies and international borders and reach out to women writing in every corner of the world. So this edition of She the People's Women's Writers Fest is titled Written and the Unwritten. I promise the day ahead is going to be full of very engaging conversations, and we have a great lineup of panels and speakers along with us. So the first panel today is we ha in the first panel today we have noted author Anuradha Roy, who is going to talk about her latest book with Archana Pai Kulkarni. Archana is our in-house books editor for She the People, and having personal experience of working with her, very few people have the tab on the publishing industry the way she has. So without wasting much time, I will hand over the session to Archana, and I welcome you, ma'am, for on behalf of She the People.
Thank you, Deepshika. Hello, everyone. A warm welcome to you all, and thank you for joining us at She the People TV's Women Writers Fest. This is a very special session. Today, I'm absolutely delighted to be in conversation with the award-winning novelist, Anuradha Roy. Anuradha Roy is the author of An Atlas of Impossible Longing, The Folded Earth, Sleeping on Jupiter, and All the Lives We Never Lived, and now The Earth Spinner. Each of her previous best-selling novels has been critically acclaimed and received multiple nominations for prestigious awards, both internationally and within India. The Booker Prize 2015, DSE Prize for Fiction 2016 winner, JCB Award for Literature 2019, Hindu Literary Award, Tata Literature Live, Book of the Year Award 2018 winner, Walter Scott Prize. She is the first Indian writer to be shortlisted alongside Anna Burns, Olga Tokarczuk, and Pat Barker for the prestigious Dublin Literary Award. Anuradha lives in Ranikhet, India. Welcome, Anuradha. It's a pleasure to be chatting with you. And congratulations on your new book, The Earth Spinner. Lovely cover. So,
Thank you. Well, thank you for that really generous introduction. The cover is done by a Colombian designer called Monica Reyes, and that horse on the cover, she actually made it and then photographed it for the
How
cover.
interesting.
She's done almost all my book covers so far.
Wonderful. So
Yeah.
let me begin by asking you, how did this book, The Earth Spinner, begin? And in fact, was your interest in pottery kindled by the book, or was it the other way around?
No, it was. I've been a potter for quite a long time, or it was definitely the other way around. The pottery came first and the book came later. But the actual spring for the book was that I began thinking of this clay horse that I had seen in my childhood. In Bengal, you make bakura horses, which are terracotta horses. And then as I grew more and more involved in pottery, I realized that these horses are made all over India for different sets of reasons. And in southern India, they have the Ayyanar horse, which is an annual festival where a huge horse is made by a whole potter's clan, which might add up to 40 or 50 people making one horse. So I began thinking about this horse. And what usually happens for me with any book is that an image or a character speaks insistently to me until I feel I have to find out more about it, and I have to write about it in order to find out more about it. So, because this was pottery, which is something I do, it was something very close to me. So I didn't dare write this book. For a very long time, I kept writing these little articles or just notes. Sometimes I'd publish the articles, often not. And then bit by bit, the world of the potter himself, who would make this horse, came to me. And then his world, which included this dog, who I had decided would be a central part of the narrative, and the girl who is mostly as the narrator. These people came in, and gradually the world of the potter grew and the novel took off.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now the book has diary entries. It is interspersed with letters. It begins in first person, switches over to third person. So now this non-adherence to a conventional form of narration, was this deliberate? And I also want to know whether it is in keeping with your earnest advocacy of the individual's right to free artistic expression, because that comes across in all your books.
Yeah, well, of course, free expression, of course, is a different thing in different contexts. I mean, freedom of expression politically is a completely different matter to the freedom to write a book as you please. And especially the novel historically has always been an extremely accommodating form. It's always, from the very start, means epistolary novels were a very 19th century form, which were completely written as letters exchanged between people. And the novel has always accommodated bits of poetry or fable, or, you know, when you read something like Moby Dick, which is another very old book, it has so many stretches which read like encyclopedia entries on the whale. So I don't think I'm doing anything very radical, but the key is really to be able to create a shape that is coherent, despite all the disparate elements that go into that narrative, and to create a flow that is not, that is not muddled or confusing. I like doubt in a novel, but I don't want it to be just confusion in my own head, which is being transferred to the page. So those were the things I had to keep in mind when writing something which included many different ways of telling a story.
So does that require a lot of revision, or does that come, I mean, it's, you know, it's one thing to write it down and then, like you said, to have this flow. So does that happen when you revise, or does that happen very naturally?
No, it doesn't happen. I mean, sometimes when you're having a really good day and life is just wonderful, it happens naturally. Then you feel like, I don't want this day to end. I wish I could just keep writing this the way it's going. But that's not always the case at all. And I'm a new, you know, I revise nonstop. I revise until almost the time the book is actually going into press. And I keep spotting things I know can be done better. So I really feel at one point the book is taken away from me and it's gone to press, and that's why I have stopped. Otherwise, I would keep revising even today.
Okay. What I find fascinating is when you spoke about writing All the Lives We Never Lived, the time when you were at a museum in Bali looking at the paintings of Walter Spies and mulling over your character, Mishkin's immersion in paintings. And then you discovered that Spies and your beloved dog had died years apart on the same date. And there was an instant connect, right? And then a whole fictional world sort of shaped up. Now, did something as magical, maybe slightly different, happen when you were working on The Earth Spinner? It's fascinating how things take shape in a novel, you know?
Yeah. In the case of The Earth Spinner, because I had this, there were a series of little things. And, you know, some of it sounds a bit stupid to tell you, but one of the things that happens in The Earth Spinner is that there's a dog. He's at the center of the story. He's actually a dog who connects everybody. Because The Earth Spinner is very much about the divides between people as well, because of identity and their religion and politics and so on. But this dog knows nothing of all those things, and the dog connects a blind Muslim calligrapher with the potter, with a girl who is going to go abroad to study. And I made up this dog, and I made up the fact that it was with the potter and all of that, and that the potter needed time, and so the dog was with the girl's family most of the day. And then strangely enough, sometime after the book was finished, just such a puppy appeared in our neighborhood, belonging to a taxi driver found this puppy and adopted it, but then did not have the time to look after it. I find it utterly bizarre that we are now babysitting this very puppy 8 hours a day. And it feels as if the book has come to life in a very weird way. But it's not something that happened before the book. I mean, with all the lives, when I saw that painting, there were things in the book which fell into place all of a sudden. But here, yes. That kind of falling into place happened through a series of, you have these moments of illumination always when you're thinking really hard about a novel. So those kinds of things kept happening. Things would keep falling into place and the book would progress.
Wonderful. Now, the characters in your novel go through painful separations from their loved ones, either through death or abandonment or circumstances or dislocation. And they carry the burden of this loss throughout their lives. And they struggle to let go of the past. So why do these themes preoccupy you so? Is this how you see the human condition?
I think loss is absolutely central, isn't it, to all our lives?
Yes.
We absolutely know from the start that we will lose people we care for. And now with the pandemic and so much loss around us, that's become even more some immediate and, you know, just all too common somehow, everywhere people coming with stories of loss. But I know that from my earliest books, it's been a central theme. And I think it's a powerful question that all fiction, not just I, but literature generally tries to address. The question of loss comes to us in so many ways. Just the other day, I was talking to someone who said that we talk a lot about dogs in our family. So, yes. In fact, somebody was saying that after he lost his first dog, his childhood dog, he never had a dog again because he was so afraid of that kind of loss, of that unhappiness. And knowing that their lifespan is shorter, but you weigh that up against the joys that dog has brought you. So that's what I mean, when you're writing or reading literature, you find, I'm reading this book right now, which is on Achilles. And it is about Achilles's deep, intense friendship with Patroclus. And yet they both know that Achilles is destined. It has been foretold that he will die in the Trojan War. So they know that the time together is very short. And so before even losing someone, they are starting to experience the prospect of loss. And so I think we encounter loss in so many different ways, in so many different contexts, that it's a very rich subject to keep exploring. It's close to many, many other themes it brings about.
Yes. And your novels also make a strong statement against submission to our prescribed existence. I mean, the way we are being told what to eat, what not to eat, what to wear, what not to wear, what faith to profess, whom to marry, and how to lead our lives. And you mentioned in an interview that you were trying to find the nerve to write about these issues.
Yeah.
So do you think now you don't have to say it obliquely and that you can say it upfront? And if you have arrived there, how did you arrive here? Because there is a loon brigade for what has been happening. So,
I think that the book is fairly, it's pretty upfront about what it is saying. That's why you're asking this question. And
yes,
as we all know, living here, we know that there are unhinged people out there who, they're a constant presence in our life, unfortunately. And I can't deny that the thought of those people is bothersome and often scary. But I think that when you are writing, you can't be afraid and write. It's hard to be cautious and to write works of, to be creative and cautious at the same time, because then you would feel so constricted, you wouldn't write anything worth reading at all. So you kind of, you take the plunge and hope for the best, but you write what you have to write. Yeah.
So you think of writing as a kind of making, like pottery, all-consuming. And you've also spoken about how you were, you know, your pottery teacher told you to throw the clay out and start all over again.
Yeah.
And the same happens with writing. So, and obviously, so what would you tell aspiring writers about this process? It can be very daunting and frustrating, isn't it?
I think it's very, very instructive to be with a really stern pottery teacher if you're planning to write, because we had this teacher. My first teacher was a potter called Bani De Roy, who had been trained by the Japanese, by a very prominent Japanese potter called Hamada. And they believed in a really austere kind of way of learning, where until you had perfected the base, you were not allowed to move forward. So therefore, this endless trying to get the perfect cylinder, which she would make us do. But that really makes you understand that, you know, you can't just slap together a book very quickly and then want it to come out the next month and it will become a bestseller or something like that. That's not how it works at all, because you, as you asked in the first question, do you revise constantly? The revision of text is my version of the reshaping endlessly of clay, so that you get to that perfect form and shape that you are looking for, and that needs a lot of work. I mean, I'm sure there are people who must be doing it with less effort, but I know that I need to work quite hard about it, you know, and read a lot. If you're talking to aspiring writers, I would always say, please just read a lot, because that's how you become a writer, by, you know, creating this rich sediment of other people's writing, that from which your own writing grows, because no writer writes on their own. They write from what they have read and experienced.
Lovely. Wonderful. Your father was a field geologist, and you have, as a child, lived in tents at camping sites. And has this early exposure to your father's work and the open spaces impacted the way you paint the landscape in your books? In fact, I can see that for The Folded Earth, you drew an imaginary map of Raniket. I have it here. And your stories have the backdrop of small towns, the sea, the hills. Is that absolutely necessary?
Well, I think it's just something that comes to me from growing up in small places. And my first 3 years as a child were spent absolutely in the outdoors, because when he had field postings we could go to, we lived there in Sikkim, in Orissa, in Bihar, in tents, in the wilderness. So my brother and I, as toddlers, were always climbing, and we were out in the wilderness. And maybe that becomes a part of you, so that when I write, I find that is the landscape I want in my head, out of which my imagination responds to that. And also I find it a very sort of useful way to situate huge human dramas in a background that is not very distracting. Like, you would hang a dramatic picture on a bare wall. You wouldn't put it with 15 other dramatic pictures. Then the whole thing falls apart. So that's how I would situate the narrative, in an open space where it has room to grow. And my father's geology is certainly in this Earth Spinner. It's very much a part of the book, because the narrator's father is a geologist, and there is a great deal about how minerals and rocks transform into clay and oxides, and you know, those things together give a pot its color and shape. So it's very, and there's also the concept of deep time, which my father gave us, which lends a completely different sense to all human endeavors, you know, the thing that the earth has been going for a billion years and we are just a little whisper and blink on this, the face of the earth.
What is your secret to choosing nice sounding names like Mishkin, Nomi, Ilango for your character? And how important is euphony to you? And also, how do you choose the titles of your books? The names are wonderful.
They take a lot of doing. I spend a lot of time on characters' names, just saying them out loud, figuring out what they mean. They have to fit the person, but they also have to fit where they are coming from. And, you know, the name has, the moment you say someone's name, so much opens up around that person. So the moment you say Mishkin, most people who have read Dostoevsky would associate him with the prince, who's a bit of an innocent. And with Ilango, I felt that this name had a music to it. And it had a kind of laziness to it. Of course, it is also ethnically correct for him. He's in southern India. And this is a name from there. It's not just some random name like Mickey Mouse or something. So many things go into the making of the name. And also, I make up the names of the towns. So all those things and the title of the book finally is quite a battle, which goes on and on. And it can go on and on and on. Because when you're deciding a title, the publisher too has to agree with your title.
He doesn't
have to, but it's better if he does, because he has to, you know, sell that book. So if you call it something idiotic, it's not going to do anything for the book.
So you began writing one-line stories in a little black book that was given to you by your mother. And when you think back, you were actually always writing all through your childhood, right? But without that consciousness that you are writing or that you're a writer. So when did you truly feel like one?
You know, I think I used to feel more consciously a writer when I was just a baby copying Winnie the Pooh stories into a notebook. I felt really important, like, I am writing this story and I am a writer. And then as time passed and as you realize the people who have written, the books you have read, I started feeling, I never felt like a writer at all. I felt less and less like a writer, because then you have bars you're measuring yourself against which are so high that you know you'll never reach them at all. So it's quite a job to convince yourself that you are going to place something out there which will be on a shelf with those other people. And they are real writers, you know, but are you someone who can be there with them? So I would say that I felt like a writer when I was 7, but ever since then, I have trouble writing writer in the column next to employment even now.
Okay. You know, Earth Spinner is peppered with letters. When you were doing your research for All the Lives We Never Lived, you read a lot of letters too.
Yeah.
So what is it about letters that you find so irresistible? And are you an avid letter writer?
I used to write lots of letters. Yes. Just from childhood, my cousins and I would exchange letters. Then it became friends. And so definitely it's been a part of my life. And then I started, when I read the letters of novelists, like Virginia Woolf has volumes and volumes of her letters, and there are many others who have their published letters, you feel you get a kind of unedited and almost an unrehearsed glimpse into the lives of people. And there's such a sense of immediacy, like someone like Virginia Woolf will say, I have to finish right now and I will come back to you 5 minutes later because the cook is knocking at the door, and she always had squabbles with this cook, so she often featured in the letters. So those kinds of things bring a sense of different sense of time and immediacy to any narrative. And so I do like using letters to change the whole way the narrative is going and turn it on its head and put it into a different time zone, way of telling, voice, everything changes.
This is quite like an excavation, isn't it? When you read a letter and it leads you somewhere else.
Absolutely. Yes. Yes.
And there is this lovely line in the Earth Spinner. It says, change was the work of the Earth spinning as it always had. And do you think the woes of your characters spring from resisting change while at the same time desiring it? And are you optimistic about the world changing into a better place? Especially after the pandemic, because things have remained pretty much the same for quite some time.
Yeah. Well, I generally just feel in the line you are quoting, it has quite a lot to do with just the way we know that there is a sense of, like I said, deep time in this. In her father's mind. Her father is the person who says this. And so he sees everything happening as something that is part of a larger thing. And so the change is a constant thing that he sees in this evolution of the larger thing that is continuously going on. And I wouldn't say the characters are resisting it. They are aware of it. We all feel we know things are changing all the time. You're sort of running hard to stay in the same place. And in fact, I think the pandemic has been a time of giant change because we would not be talking in this way before it. We would be together in a room and we'd be able to see each other properly and everything. So in fact, if you look at the pandemic, we have been incredibly resourceful at adapting to a completely unknown disease and a different way of being that it required us to be. People living alone, isolation, months on end, years on end, that kind of thing. So I think I do feel optimistic that we have coped with this. We have managed to emerge from it, some of us at least. Many were very, very unlucky. Some have come out of it feeling sort of exhausted and as if you're in a new world where you have to find your feet again. But we are trying to, and I think, of course, we will somehow.
Wonderful. Okay. You speak with utmost regard about your publisher, Christopher McLehose, and with mock annoyance about the acerbic marginalia from your husband, Rukun. What happens when you disagree with their views, and how do you deal with the turmoil of their criticism, however constructive it may be? That must be tough.
Yeah. Right? Oh, you bet. It is very tough when somebody in the house is reading your book, when it's just a draft. Because if he is not reading it, then you wonder why he's not reading it. If he is reading it, then you're watching his face to see, is he looking really fed up and irritated, or does he look as if it's going well? So all along you're trying not to look, but you're looking to see what's going on because he's your first reader. And then there will be discussions that are often incredibly energetic. But both Rukun and Christ, with both of them, in fact, because everyone has different points of view, which they are all equally convinced about. But both of them know and completely respect the fact that I know what I want to write and that I have given them the book to read and comment on, but they are not going to tell me what to write. They will tell me what worked for them, what didn't work for them, and then I will figure out what I want to do depending, on their, whatever they have thought matters a huge amount to me and often really alters the book for the better, but I do often ignore what they've said because I know what I want to do. Yeah.
Wonderful. So you live in the hills with your dogs, and dogs have played an important role in your books, and the Earth Spinner features the adorable Chinna. So do you see yourself writing a book with a dog as a protagonist?
Well, I think, you know, this is the thing. I think that apart from the potter, it is the dog who is the protagonist in this book. I feel he's one of the central characters who knits everyone together. And although he has no speaking part, he is very crucial in the book. So to me, this is a book with a dog at its center. And he's a kind of combination of many of my dogs who I've had over the years, and who are embodied in this composite form in Chinna. Because Chinna to me is really, I've always had only, I've had dogs I've found, stray dogs, who become our own dogs at home. And Chinna to me typifies the Indian stray dog, who has a very special place in Indian life, whether in the village or the city, which is unique, that they are a part of that community. Very many people are horrible to them and brutal to them, but there are also people who are kind to them, and who they are known by different names in different localities. They have different relationships depending on which tea shop they sit at. So Chinna to me is that Indian dog who is there absolutely everywhere.
Yes. One last question. What is a day in your life like? Because there's so much that you're juggling. Design at your publishing house. I believe you paint also, right? And pottery and writing. So, you know, that will help a lot of people who want to write and don't know how to juggle things.
Yeah, I've often had people who say, I really do want to write, but I don't have the time. And I think that they should not be writing, because if you need, you should only write if you need to. Because all the time that you write, you have to be completely aware that maybe nobody will read it. Maybe it will never get published. But will you still be happy to have spent that time writing that? Will you still be okay that you made that effort and you wrote that? But you will only, it will only be fulfilling for you if you needed and wanted to write it for yourself. So, and when you do have that need to write, then the time appears. I mean, in spite of jobs, children, housework, everything, people who write will say that there are so many women writers who are interviewed who say, you know, people like Alice Munro, and who would say she got 2 hours and she would spend that 2 hours writing. Or people who have children who would say they put them to bed and only wrote when the children were in bed, or when the children went to school, then they had a little more time to write. So I think you plan your day so that you make that time somehow. You will. It's like thirst. You need the water, you'll find it and drink it.
Thank you, Anuradha. This has been a wonderful session. Thank you for your time. Thank you, viewers, for being
so much. And thank you for the incredible care with which you read the books.